Jesus' trial before Caiaphas ended in the early hours of the morning. Then he was taken to the headquarters of the Roman governor. His accusers didn't go inside because it would defile them, and they wouldn't be allowed to celebrate the Passover. So Pilate, the governor, went out to them and asked, "What is your charge against this man?" "We wouldn't have handed him over to you if he weren't a criminal," they retorted. "Then take him away and judge him by your own law," Pilate told them. "Only the Romans are permitted to execute someone," the Jewish leaders replied. This fulfilled Jesus' prediction about the way he would die. Then Pilate went back into his headquarters and called for Jesus to be brought to him. "Are you the king of the Jews?" he asked him. Jesus replied, "Is this your own question, or did others tell you about me?" "Am I a Jew?" Pilate retorted. "Your own people and your leading priests brought you to me for trial. Why? What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not an earthly kingdom. If it were, my followers would fight to keep me from being handed over to the Jewish leaders. My kingdom is not of this world." Pilate said, "So you are a king?" Jesus responded, "You say I am a king. Actually, I was born and came into the world to testify to the truth. All who love the truth recognize that what I say is true." "What is the truth? What is truth?" Pilate asked. Then he went out again to the people and told them, "He is not guilty of any crime. But you have a custom of asking me to release one prisoner each year at Passover. Would you like me to release this king of the Jews?" But they shouted back, "No, not this man. We want Barabbas." Barabbas was a revolutionary. Today's sermon is titled, "What is Truth?" and will be delivered by Pastor Stephen Lockies.
The grace and peace of Christ be with us all today. Even though I look the same as normal, look the same as always, there's something a little different about me today. That's because I'm actually not here in my normal role, my usual role as the pastor for the EM. Instead, I'm actually standing here as a professor representing the Tainan Theological College and Seminary, which is a shame. I thought I'd have this week off. Today is the TTCS fundraising Sunday. So upstairs, our college principal is preaching to the Taiwanese congregation, and the college has asked me to take over and put on my professor's hat and to represent our school here in the EF. The Tainan Seminary, it's really a very special place. It was founded 141 years ago in 1876, and not only is it the oldest theological school in Taiwan, but it's one of the oldest theological schools in the whole Asia-Pacific region. And while our main task at the college is really to train the next generation of pastors for churches here in Taiwan, our reputation, our background, and our global connections, well, that means that we have an important international responsibility as well. Every year we have a good number of international students who come to study with us. Many are from the Asia-Pacific region, but many also come from even further away. So this year I have one student from the US, and I even have one student from Argentina. I find it really great that we can do this. I find it really great that we can be globally focused and globally connected in this way. It's great to draw students, draw people from all other places around the world so they can come and study here in Taiwan and get to know Taiwan and know what a great place it is, and then take that knowledge back to their home countries. Of course, we also do it the other way around. This year, two of my graduate students will go to the UK for their doctoral studies. One will go to Edinburgh in Scotland, and one will go to Cambridge. So it's great that we can send our bright Taiwanese students out into the world as well. They can represent Taiwan and all the great things about Taiwan at some of the world's greatest universities. And I think in future they'll be a great blessing for our churches when they come home. first lessons I teach my students every year is about the church, about the nature of the church and the role and purpose of the church in the world. As future pastors, it's important for them to know what the church is all about. It's important for them to know what their roles are. It's important to know what the church is supposed to do and why we're here. There are two main tasks for the church that I teach them. There are these two main tasks, or what we could call the two hands of the church. One is to be a justice-seeking community, what we call a justice-seeking community. That means to be a community of people who go out into the world and change things for the better. We can call this the work of God's kingdom, helping the poor and sick, reaching out to those who are in need, and working to help people get out of situations of abuse and harm that they find themselves in. That's why we here at the EM do a lot of this type of work. We reach out to a lot of people in need, whether it's at-risk youth or women in need or struggling families or others. And it's the reason why in so many places around the world, in war zones, in countries facing famines or injustice or other disasters, we so often find great Christians, good committed Christians, working there, working hard to make a difference, working hard to share God's love and compassion with others. And of course, it's the reason why when Christian missionaries came to Taiwan so many years ago, Christian missionaries like Mackay, they didn't just bring Bibles or use just words to talk about Jesus. They also used their hands. They used their actions. They used their whole lives to help people in Taiwan. They built hospitals. They built schools. They built clinics and orphanages. They cared for people here who were in need. Because after all, that's what Christ calls us, his disciples, to do. To love others and to care for others. Jesus even tells us it's through our love and care for other people that they'll know that we are Christ's disciples, that we are his followers, and that we're working for his kingdom. But the other task for us in the church is to be what we call a truth-seeking community. We gather here together, we read the Bible, we speak and hear about God, because we're searching for what's true. We want to know what's true. What's God's will for us? What's the truth of life? How do we understand the world around us, and how should we live? I have to confess, it always disappoints me a little bit when I meet people who think that to be a Christian means you have to leave your brain at the church door before coming in. People who think that a life of faith is not a life of thinking at all. Of course, we have to confess that stereotype doesn't come from nowhere. Sadly, there are really some Christians who try to close their eyes to the world, to close their minds to understanding the world. But that's not only very sad, it's also not what Jesus wants us to do. Christ calls us to love God not only with all our hearts, but also to love God with all of our minds. And while some other church traditions do focus more on feelings, the feelings of faith, I have to say, in our Reformed and Presbyterian traditions, we've always tended to stress a really very serious academic and intellectual approach to faith and to knowledge of God. I think it's one of the reasons our congregations tend to be weighted so much more towards very educated, highly educated people. We look around us here and we see doctors, surgeons, researchers, physicists, leaders in technology, business, law, politics, environment, and dozens of other fields. We are people who take knowledge seriously. We're people who take truth seriously. I remember inviting a friend to come and be a guest preacher for us here at the EM, and I remember how worried he was. He told me he looked at our EM webpage at the list of guest preachers, and it was just this long, long list of Reverend Doctor, Reverend Doctor, Reverend Doctor, one after the other. He said, it looked like you can't preach at the EM without a PhD. I told him, no, that's not really true, but it is right that our EM congregation has high standards. We need to be a truth-seeking community. We need to be focused on truth, on wisdom, on knowledge. But when we look around the world today, sometimes it feels like there's not a great lot of interest in truth anymore. Over the last few months, many of you will have seen how a lot of the world and a lot of the world's media have focused on this problem, especially in the US. Next slide. We're seeing how Trump and his government come out every day and say all kinds of nonsense, saying things that are completely untrue. They talk about so-called alternative facts or alternative truths, and then reject reports about the truth, the so-called fake news. By doing this over and over, by spreading confusion and nonsense and lies every day, many people end up in a situation where they just aren't really sure anymore. Not sure what's true and what's not true. People don't know what they should believe and what they shouldn't believe. That's when we see truth starting to disappear. Words start to lose their meaning. Reality starts to lose meaning. The people start giving up on even caring about whether something is true or not. That's why recently many academics and many researchers, they've started talking about the world today as being in a post-truth era, a post-truth time. We're in a time where it seems like truth isn't so important, where truth has no meaning, where we no longer really care about what's true and what's not. Now, when we get to that stage when truth is no longer important or no longer cared about, all that's left then really is power, the power to do anything, and to call it right, and to call it good and true if you want to, even when it's not. Now, of course, we don't have to look at the US for these types of examples. It's been around for a long time. And it's not just governments or politicians where we see this problem of truth. I think a quick look at our Facebook pages or at Line shows just how much we ordinary people also love passing around stories that seem to be true, that pretend to be true, but really aren't true at all. Do we care about things not being true? Do we care about things not being real? Should we just give up on truth? We may be entering a post-truth era today, but it's not actually a new problem at all. It was already an issue back in the days of Jesus, and we see that in today's scripture. We see that in Jesus' trial before Pilate. It's there from the very beginning of the story. In today's passage, we read how the Jewish leaders brought Jesus to Pilate, and the first thing that Pilate demands to know is, well, what's the charge against this guy? What's the charge against Jesus? What's the crime that they're accusing him of? It's such an ordinary question. It's such an ordinary, logical, reasonable question to ask. As the Roman governor, Pilate knows that that's the normal process of law. We need to know what the charge is. We need to hear witnesses. We need to talk, to investigate, to argue, to hear both sides of the story, and then come to a decision about what's true. Come to a decision about what the truth of the matter or the truth of the charge is. Are the charges true and proven, or are they not? That's what a court, that's what a trial is for. And really, I think the Jewish leaders knew that too. That's not a surprising thing. But in this case, truth seems to be the last thing that's on their minds. Pilate asks them what the charge is, and they respond really angrily. What's it matter? What's it matter what the accusation is? He's a bad guy. He's a criminal. Just believe us. Just trust us. Don't worry about the facts. We still see this same kind of woke mentality today. I think we still deal with this bad side to human nature, which so often just wants to push past the facts, to push past the truth, and instead just blindly reach out for ideas that we think are true already. There's always that temptation to ignore facts or to ignore the truth. That temptation to think that, well, the truth just gets in the way of what we really wish were real. But that's the way that abusive powers often work. They tell us to forget the facts, ignore the truth, and just go straight on to demands. So notice how the Jewish leaders bring Jesus to Pilate, not really to be tried, but to be executed. They know what they want. They've already decided on the punishment, even. The actual details of the crime and the accusation, though, well, maybe we can just fill those in later. But even Pilate knows that this isn't the way it's supposed to be. Even Pilate knows this is completely wrong. You don't decide on a punishment first and then go searching for a crime second. Maybe that's why in verse 31, Pilate doesn't seem to want anything to do with this trial. If the Jews want to have a faith trial, they can go run it themselves. But we see that the Jewish leaders insist and demand Pilate take over. So with no details, Pilate has to investigate this case for himself. He needs to understand it. He needs to know what the charge is. And so, logically, to Jesus. That's what starts us on this fascinating discussion between Jesus and Pilate. In verse 35, Pilate directly says to Jesus, Your own people and their leading priests, they brought you to me for trial. Why? What have you done? On one hand, I think this why question is really reasonable, is really sensible. We want to know the reason why. Why is Jesus hated so much? Why have the leaders arrested him? Why do they want him there? At first, it seemed like the reason was that Jesus was claiming to be a new king. It seemed like that was the charge, that Jesus was the new king of the Jews, a revolutionary leader who would help the Jews to fight back against the Romans. But Pilate asked about that accusation, and he himself doesn't believe it. Pilate's smart enough to know that Jesus is no terrorist. So he comes back to this question. He comes back to this question again. Why, Jesus? What have you done? What have you done to be handed over by the people and hated so much by them? On the one hand, we said that was a reasonable question to ask. But on the other hand, I think we can also say that it's a little bit of a naive question too, one that doesn't show very much understanding or very deep understanding of human nature. Because I think, as too many of us know, sometimes people don't need a good reason to know. Sometimes people hate others without much reason at all. We look around us in this world and see some people who do horrible things, lying, hurting, abusing others. And the result is that they are accepted, cheered on, and even looked up to, even admired for being so strong. Others spending their lives trying to do good things, trying their hardest to care for others, treating others with compassion and respect. And as a result, they end up being hated and rejected for them. Does it make any sense? Is that connected to truth in any way? I remember one day a woman came to me in tears and told me how her husband's family has spent years making her life hell and that she just can't take it anymore. She had tried her hardest, she said. She had tried her hardest to be kind and helpful and respectful. She cared for her husband's parents. She gave them everything they needed, but the harder she tried, the more her mother-in-law seemed to hate her. Why? she asked me in tears. What have I done to be hated so much by you? And sometimes that's just the way people are. Sometimes people don't need a reason to hate. Sometimes there's no logical or sensible answer. Maybe that's why Jesus doesn't directly answer Pilate's question. Instead, in verse 36, he changes the topic. Pilate had asked Jesus what he had done for his own people, his own nation, to have handed him over to the Romans in this way. But instead of answering that question, Jesus picks up Pilate's assumption that Jesus and the Jews actually belonged to the same group, that they were the same people, that the Jews counted as Jesus' people. Let's go to the next slide. So Pilate comes to Jesus and asks, what did you do for your people to hand you over this way? But Jesus rejects this and he says to Pilate, no, his kingdom and his people are very different. His kingdom isn't one that's built on race or on nationality. It's not built on earthly power or earthly authority. Jesus says his kingdom is built on truth. In Jesus' kingdom, the focus is not on abusive power, but on what is true and on what is real. And the people who are part of Jesus' kingdom aren't limited to just the Jews or to any one nation or to any one race. The people who belong to Christ are all of those who join him, all of those who join him in being devoted to truth and devoted to love. That's why Jesus' kingdom is so unlike others in this world. It's very easy for us to misunderstand Jesus' meaning here when he says that his kingdom is not an earthly kingdom. What that doesn't mean is that Jesus' kingdom and Jesus' rule has nothing to do with this world. It doesn't mean that at all. That would make Jesus and his teachings completely irrelevant to us and to our lives. No, Jesus is the Lord of this world, and he's the Lord of our lives. And Jesus wants us to work in this world, to work to have this world become his kingdom, to be transformed into his kingdom. But the difference here is that Jesus' kingdom is not like others, in that other kingdoms are based on violent power and authority, especially power that comes from someone else. After all, Pilate had authority. Herod was a leader, was a king. But their authority, their leadership, it all came from someone else. Others made them rulers. And others can take that authority away from them again, too. But Christ is not like that. Christ isn't a king because his nation made him a king. He's not a king because the Jewish people used their power to ask him to be their king. Jesus isn't like Caesar, who has fighters and military troops holding him up and giving him the power to rule. Christ is king not through someone else's permission or power. Christ is king because of who he is. Now, whereas other kingdoms use violence and lies or huge military budgets to grab hold of power, Christ is king because he stands on truth, because he is truth. In this world of swirling deceptions and lies and attacks and fakery, in this world of post-truth, where only lies seem important for power, Christ holds himself up as different. Christ holds himself up as a true king, as one who calls us to truth. He's the solid rock in the middle of all of this mess. And he's the one calling us back to hold on to what is right and good and true. And Jesus offers us citizenship in his kingdom. When we join Jesus, when we listen to his voice, when we focus on truth and live for what is right and true, that's when we become members of his kingdom. That's when we become followers of the true king. That all sounds so good. That sounds good, doesn't it? So grand, it sounds so wonderful, especially to us Christians. But as we see in verse 38, Pilate's not very impressed by Jesus' answer. Truth? You want to depend on truth? What's truth? And in a world so in love with power and violence and hate, what use is truth? Jesus stands there. Jesus stands there before Pilate, beaten and bloody and abused, one step away from death. And it doesn't look like truth is doing much good for him there. I think the practical people of the world would say, you know, Jesus, maybe it's time to give up on the whole truth business. Maybe it's time to abandon truth, to forget about it. Maybe they would say, well, Jesus, you should stop being so idealistic. You should wake up to the way the world really works. In Jesus' time, just as in ours today, the world so often just didn't care about what was true. The world much preferred what was useful, even if that was built on lies. The world preferred a strong man, a man of power and violence, a man of action like Barabbas. That was someone they could get behind, someone who was ready to kill and hate, someone ready to leave truth behind and do whatever it takes to push a plan ahead. Jesus isn't on trial before Pilate because of truth. He's there because people, religious people, gave up on the idea of truth, gave up on the idea that truth was valuable or useful or good. Better to have a fighter like Barabbas than someone who stands announcing the truth. Jesus comes announcing to the world that he's the way, he's the life, and he is the truth. But as he stands there, beaten and in chains before Pilate, it seems like the world and even the people of faith that were around Jesus, it seemed like they preferred something different. They preferred a way of deception, a life of violence, and weren't too interested in truth. In the very last sentence of John's Gospel, John tells us that there aren't enough books in the whole world to hold all of the stories about Jesus' life. So he's only given us some stories. He's only given us those stories that are most important for us and for the church. So why has John given us this story? Why has he given us this story about Jesus and Pilate's very difficult, very philosophical discussion about truth? I think it's because John knows that this is a temptation for all people. I think it's because John knows that just as it was a great temptation for those faithful Jews, for those faithful religious leaders to abandon truth, it's also a danger for us in the church as well. The world around us shows us just how easy it is to give in to that temptation, to give in to the temptation of ignoring facts or closing our eyes to truth and hearing just what we want to hear. Like those Jewish believers in Jesus' day, it's easy for us Christians to give in to the temptations of power and influence, to focus on what we want rather than to focus on what is true. It's easy to spend our lives trying to get what we want and using any way we can to get it, instead of using wisdom, understanding, knowledge, and perseverance to search for what is true and to stand up for what is true. But if we did that, if we forgot about truth, if we settled for less, if we followers of truth gave up defending truth, defending what is right and good and true, would anyone else do it? When we look through the history of the church, we find that there have been really far too many cases where the church really has given into that temptation, where the church has caused disasters and hurt, where the church's actions has led to so many problems, so many, because they turned away from the truth of Christ. For us today in Taiwan, it's so important for us to learn from those experiences so we don't have to do them too. Are we perfect people? No, of course not. Are our churches perfect? No, we're not perfect either. But that's especially why we need a new generation of pastors. A new generation of pastors who know how to open their eyes to the truth. To open their hearts to search for what's true. And to work with Jesus to help his kingdom of truth and love come into our world. I've had the privilege of seeing many of my students graduate and become great pastors. Great pastors doing great work in churches all around Taiwan. And I'm really proud of all of them. I hope that with the support of good Christians in Taiwan, Christians who keep demanding the highest possible standards from their pastors and who keep demanding a focus on truth, that with this type of focus, this type of passion for what is true, that we can keep doing this great work. Let's pray together. Our Lord Jesus, the world around us is already so dark and uncertain, and there are many who work to make things even darker and to work against the truth. Lord, you are the light of truth. So let your light shine brightly in our world today. Open our eyes so we can see through the darkness of doubt and vapor. Open our minds so that we're always demanding truth and always seeking it. And give us good leaders. Good leaders in our countries and in our churches. Leaders who care for what is right, good, and true. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's take this opportunity to stand and redevote our lives to following Christ, following Jesus, who is the way, the life, and the truth. Let's pray together. Most merciful God, we confess to you before the whole company of heaven and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. Forgive us our sins, heal us by your Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy. Forgive us all of our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen us in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us following the way of Jesus Christ. Amen.